It is a big pleasure for me to introduce you the talk of Wanderson Lima from Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Sul. He's going to talk about a two-piece property for free boundary minimal surfaces in the ball. Thank you very much, Wanderson, for your participation in the workshop.
Well, thank you very much, Asun. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. This morning, I realized that I lived for 7 years in Rio de Janeiro, but I never been at UFI. Unfortunately, this is not the first time I'll be at UFI. I hope sometime in the future I can give a
The
talk.
invitation is still open. The invitation is still open for the future.
Okay, thank you.
Always
Perfect.
welcome.
Thank you. It will be a pleasure. Okay. Everything I will talk is joint work with Ana Menezes from Princeton University. Okay, a short plan of the talk. I'll give some motivation to study free boundary minimal surfaces. I'll talk a little bit about the theory of free boundary minimal surface in the Euclidean tree ball. Then I'll talk about the main result, which is the so-called two-piece property. And I'll say a little thing about applications of this two-piece property. Okay. Feel free to interrupt any time to ask questions. Okay, one motivation to study free boundary minimal surface, of course, when you look at the variational point of view, you have a Riemannian tree manifold with boundary, and you consider an immersive surface. In all the talk, I will consider the case where the intersection of this compact surface of the ambient is the boundary of the surface itself, is the so-called proper immersive case. Okay. So what I mean by a critical point with frame boundary? So consider the situation where we have the surface sigma, and you consider variations where the boundary of the surface in the variation are contained in the boundary of the ambient. Okay. So for every variation of this kind, we have the derivative of the area at zero, then you say this is a critical point with free boundary of the area. Okay, of course, a way of taking variations is consider a vector field which generates the variation. And on this situation, with this condition about the boundary, the variational vector field satisfies that it is tangent to the boundary of the ambient at points P on the boundary. Okay. So if we look at the first variation of area formula, and the derivative of the area is given by that. So if you assume this is zero, we will obtain a geometric characterization of these critical points. So the mean curvature vector vanishes, and the surface sigma is orthogonal to the boundary of the ambient along its out boundary. So this explains the name free boundary, okay? Free boundary, because the boundary is not fixed, and okay, is varying, and you have necessary this orthogonality condition. For example, think about if the ambient is homeomorphic to a solid toroid, solid torus, and you can prove that you can minimize area along disks and obtain a disk with which is a minimum of the area and is free boundary. Okay, a picture like this. Okay, this is one natural geometric motivation to study these objects. So now I want to give a motivation to study this problem specifically in the Euclidean triball. So one motivation comes from the so-called Steklov problem. Any Riemannian compact surfaces. So we'll define the Dirichlet to Neumann map as the following. Take a function, a symphony function, which is defined on the boundary of the surface. Then you take the harmonic extension with respect to the Laplacian of the metric G. Then you take the unit out of point conormal at the boundary of sigma. Then you take this normal derivative of the harmonic extension. Okay, so this is called the Dirichlet Neumann map. So one can check that L defines a non-negative self-adjoint operator, which has discrete spectrum. So we have a spectrum, the I'll call sigma zero the as eigenfunction, which is zero. So, and I will, in my convention, I will call sigma one, sigma two, the remaining eigenfunctions. So this analytical problem has a nice relationship with free boundary Riemann surface. I think the first one to realize this was Fraser and Chen. They proved the following, and consider a surface inside a some Euclidean ball of n dimension, and suppose there's condition of properly immersive. Then sigma is a free boundary minimal surface if when you consider sigma inside Pn, then you have the coordinate functions, okay, restrict to sigma. So sigma is free boundary if only if these functions are eigenfunctions of the Dirichlet Neumann map with eigenvalue 1. So this guy is 1. Okay, so this is a very nice characterization. So it is, in fact, this subject of free boundary minimal surface is very old since the solution of the plateau problem by Douglas and Rado. There were people that were interested by this problem, for example, Kuhn. But in the last years, thanks to this link between the Dirichlet Neumann map and the free boundary minimal surface, there will be some great work about the minimal surface in the ball. Okay, so this is two motivations. These are two motivations to study the problem. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the free boundary minimal surface in the ball. So we have two basic examples. This so-called equatorial discs. So you take, in my assumption, the Euclidean triball is the unit Euclidean triball, okay, with center of the arch. So you take any plane which passes through the orange. So the intersection of the plane with the ball is a disk which is free boundary. Okay, this is a very simple example. Of course, you can rotate this disk, you obtain a family of disk of this kind. So the next basic example is the critical catalog. So you do the following. You take a family of catenoids, let's say with center zero in the sense that the x of rotation is the vertical zx passed through the orange. So you take a catenoid like this, and you can rescale the catenoid, and you can prove the for some scale we will obtain a surface which is entirely contained of the ball, and which meet the boundary orthogonally. So this is also an example of free boundary minimal surface. So these two are very basic examples. You don't have to do anything hard to find them. But there are a lot of interesting things about them. So let's talk a little bit about the unicity problems related to these two examples. For example, you have this theorem by Nietzsche, which says that suppose that sigma is a free boundary minimal disk. There is a free boundary minimal surface which is homeomorphic to the disk. The necessary sigma is an equatorial disk. So let me say something. There is a string analogy which is guiding the community between closed minimal surface in the round tree sphere. And free boundary minimal surface in between. So this result we can see is the analog that the equatorial spheres are the unique minimal spheres in round tree sphere. Is it a special case of the result that Professor Galvez talked about yesterday? Okay, now you can think about what about the catenoid? There is some kind of unicity. So there is this conjecture about the catenoid by Fries and Lee, which says the following. Suppose that sigma is an embedded free boundary minima annulus, then sigma is congruent to the critical catenoid. Okay? So this is the analog of the Lawson conjecture, which we know is true by Brendel, which says that the Clifford torus is the only embedded minimal torus in the around sphere up to congruence. Okay. So this is one of the problems which is guiding the community. I know a lot of people who try to prove this. I will say something about more about this conjecture at the end of the talk. So another problem which is interesting. Okay, we'll just come back. We have the first variation, but we can take also the second variation and look at some kind of stability problem. So we have a quadratic form, and you can define an index for this quadratic form. Okay. So we can prove that, for example, the disk has index 1, and there is no surface with index 0. So interesting problem is to calculate the index of the critical catenoid. So as to see the importance of this problem, people were very interested. Three group of people independently proved this, that the index of the critical catenoid is 4. So have the Weaver, I don't know if the pronunciation is correct. Then Hugh Tran, which we presented yesterday, and Graham Smith and the Tang Zhu. The Tang is one of the organizers. So a problem related to this result is the following. Suppose that you have a compact free boundary minimal surface. And suppose that the index is 4. So it's true that sigma is congruent to the critical Gaussian. So why people believe that is true? As I said, if we do the analogy with the round sphere, it is the result of Urbano, which says that the index of a closed minimal surface, which is not a equatorial sphere, is greater than or equal to 5. And if it's 5, it's necessarily the equivalent torus. So if we do this analogy, it is natural to think about this problem. And also, let me remind you that this result of Urbano is a key step on the proof of the Ullmann conjecture by Marx and Neves. So it's one of the motivations to people to think about this problem, because it's natural to think that if you want to prove an analogous result of to the Ullmann conjecture to the setting of B3 and free boundary minimal surface, maybe the result of this kind will be necessary. Okay, so the results progress on this problem. For example, on the same paper that Trim proved the result of the index, he proves that if sigma is embedded, it has exactly 2 boundary components. Então, then this result is true. Okay. Okay. So even if these 2 examples of very basic, there are interesting questions about them. Let's see more examples. So, it's a groundbreaking work of Fraser and Chen, where they, among other things, find a class of examples. The examples have genus 0 and k boundary components with k very large. So, the technique is interesting. You try to maximize the following functional. You take any metric on the surface with this topology, and you try to maximize the first Stackelbeck eigenvalue times the area, the length of the boundary with respect to the metric G. Okay, so they find that in this case we have the maximum, which is obtained by a surface we can realize this free boundary minimal surface in the ball. So the idea is that for k large enough, when you in the k is going to plus infinity, this surface resemble a kind of doubling of the equatorial disk. You can think of 2 copies of a disk, and you join the disks by some kind of half catenoids. Okay. So of course, the number of boundary components will be counted by the number of breaks. Yeah. Okay. Let me just say this, the picture is just a sketch. Okay, we don't know exactly how is the geometry of the surface. So, we have now a lot of works which you find families of examples. And we have essentially 2 techniques, which are Green techniques, which are in the sense of PDE, and you have the min-max theory. So let's fix this notation, call gamma the genus of the surface and k the number of boundary components. So Next to Frazer and Chen, we have these examples by Folha, Pacá, and Zotoraleva, which is a Russian mathematician. And just say that Abigail Folha is also one of the organizers of this workshop. So the idea is use these GUI techniques. So they obtain two families of examples. And one family with the same topology of the Frazer and Chen examples. They are the same, but it is reasonable to expect so. And also examples with genus 1 and very large boundary components. You can think it's kind of, you take this picture and you put a hole in the middle, something like this. Then, using MinMax, Gitover produced examples which are kind of resemble the Costa-Hoffmann mixed surface in R3. So it's kind of a desingularization of the intersection of the critical catenoid with the equatorial disk. And here again, we have to a condition that the genus has to be very high. So it's an open problem if we can construct the surface with every genus possible. In particular, it's very interesting problem if there is a analogous of the Costa surface, which of course is very important for both of the surfaces, this surface, okay? Also, Capuiz and Lee, using the GUI technique, you produce examples with the same topology. We also expect there should be the same examples, but there is no proof yet. Okay, and also in the same papers, the two group of people produce examples with dihedral symmetry. Okay, Ketover also using MIMAX produced examples with the symmetries of platonic solids. For example, here's the sketch of a surface with the symmetries of the cube. Then Capuiz and Wigel, using GUI technique, produced these very interesting examples, which have high genus and just one boundary component. So why this example is very interesting? Because you have this unicity result, right? Here you fix the genus to be zero and the number of boundary components to be one. We can think of the problem if you fix just the number of the boundary components to be one, we should expect unicity. Well, these examples show that no. So you can have surface with just one boundary component and high genus. So the idea is now is in some way you can triple the equatorial disk instead of double, okay? So you obtain something like this. And finally, last year, Carlotto, Franz, and Schultz announced this result using MIMAX theory that for any genus, you can find a free boundary minimal surface in the ball with just one boundary component. So as you see, the theory is developing very fast, and you have a lot of interesting examples. As you know, examples are very important to the theory of minimal surfaces, okay? Okay, so let's talk now about the main result, which is the so-called two-piece property. So as I said before, we have this analogy between closed minimal surface in the round tree sphere and the free boundary minimal surface in the ball. So a very nice, very beautiful result about minimal surface in the sphere is due to Ross, is the following. So suppose you have an embedded closed minimal surface on the round tree sphere. Any equatorial sphere, a plane on R4 intersect with the round tree sphere. The surface sigma is equal to the sphere, or the sphere divides sigma in exactly two components. Okay? So it's a very beautiful result with a geometric and topological nature at the same time. So, despite being very beautiful, also this result is interesting because gives evidence to a conjecture due to Yao. The conjecture is older than the theorem, says the following. Suppose we have an embedded closed minimal surface on the sphere, then the conjecture says that the first non-zero eigenvalue of the Laplacian is equal to 2. Okay, so assume the conjecture is true, then we can prove the two-piece property. So why? Because if you use the Kuhn nodal domain, we know that the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian satisfies that any eigenfunction has at most two nodal domains. Okay? So if you take you can think in sigma inside S3 inside R4. So you can think in a function like this. The position times V, where V is the normal to some hyperplane in R4, and you took the intersection with this in R3, and you have an equatorial sphere. So you can easily prove that this surface will be an eigenfunction with eigenvalue 2. So it has to be a first eigenfunction, so it has at most two nodal domains. So the two-piece property follows. Ross was to prove the two-piece property without requiring to know if the conjecture is true or not. The evidence is true, the conjecture which is still open. So, me and Anna thought about the case of free boundary minimal surface. Maybe there is some analogous result. So we'll prove the following. Suppose that M is a free boundary minimal surface, which is compact embedded in the Euclidean tree ball. Then you take any equatorial disk. So either M is this disk, or the disk divides M in exactly two components. So this is the analog of the two-piece property. And the analogy goes further. We have an analog of the conjecture of Yao, now due to Fraser and Lee. So in the same assumption, free boundary minimal surface, compact embedded, says that the first non-zero stack log eigenvalue of sigma is equal to 1. So instead of the eigenvalue of the Laplacian, we take the eigenvalue of the stack log problem. So the idea is the same. Now you can think is a disk is the intersection of a plane on R3. So we have a normal vector, so we take the function, which is position times the vector. So it's easy to see that the Laplacian is zero and the normal derivative satisfies this. So this is an eigenfunction. So the restriction to the boundary is a eigenfunction of the Steklov problem with eigenvalue 1. Analog of the Kuhn-Nodal domain for non-zero Steklov eigenvalues. Say the same thing. If you have the n eigenvalue, then we have at most n plus 1 nodal domains. So you can prove the two-piece property assuming this conjecture. So in the same way, our result gives evidence to this conjecture. Let me just say that on the same papers about the index of the catenoid, Duvivier and Tran prove that this is true if the index is 4. Of course, we expect the index 4 is just the catenoid, right? Okay. So let me give a sketch of the proof of the two-piece property. So just remind you of the notation. You have the free boundary, minimal surface sigma, and we have a disk. So first, the result is, of course, true for if M is a disk. Okay, you have just to look to intersection of planes on R3. So you can suppose that M is not an equatorial disk. And suppose by contradiction that D divides M in more than two components, okay? So we have some steps. The first step is of the proof is to think of a partial free boundary plateau problem. It's okay. So consider a connected component M1 of M minus D, and you call gamma the boundary of M1. So is a result proved by Frazen and Lee that the complement of M minus D, yeah? Is the complement of the bound binds M. Okay. So we have two domains which have some simple topology on the sense that they are compression boundaries. So in this case of the catenoid, you can think is W is this domain here. Again, is W prime is this side domain. Okay. So the idea is to fix one of the domains, for example, W, and want to consider some kind of partially free boundary problem. Okay. So the curve gamma is inside the surface M, right? So For example, if you take a plane like this, so the disk is contained here. So the curve will be something like this. Okay. So you want to consider the following problem. Want to minimize area along surface in such a way that you keep the fixed to allow that the rest of the boundary necessary has the inside the boundary of the ball, which is the sphere. But now that this yellow curve can vary, okay? So especially free boundary, because some portion of the boundary is fixed, which is gamma. But we allow the some other portion is necessary inside the sphere, but varies, okay? So consider this type of plateau problem, which minimize area along this condition, and with the another condition that the surface has to be necessary inside the domain W. Okay. So how can you solve this problem? So what we have to do is to solve the problem in the sense of a geometric measure theory. So instead of surface, we'll be thinking about currents. If you don't know what is a current, no problem. You can just think in this kind of generalization of surface, so that the space now has good compactness properties. So here the conditions, we want the surface to be inside W, and we want this condition about the boundary. Some part is fixed, some part varies inside the sphere. Okay, so classical results in geometric measure theory says that there is a minimizer for the area. Actually, in this case, we minimize with the so-called mass. But when you look at the surface is a current, we can prove that the mass is equal to the area. So this is not so hard. If you know basic results of GMT, okay, this is fine. But now, what we get is a current, but we want a surface, right? So we need some kind of regularity result. So the first step is to prove a kind of maximum principle. So denote sigma by the support of the current, okay? So we want to prove that this sigma is regular in some sense. So the first thing we have to prove that is either sigma is contained of the boundary of the domain or the intersection of the surface with the boundary of the domain is just the boundary of sigma itself. Okay, this is a maximal principle in the sense of varifolds. You can think varifold is another kind of object in geometric measure theory, but you can think for, you can see that for a red fiber two current, there is a associated varifold. So me and Anna proved the maximal principle for in this setting. This is reminiscent of work of Brian White. I think it was the first one to prove a maximum principle to manifolds. So it's kind of an adaptation. Okay, now that we know this, we can use the regularity theory. So the regularity theory says that sigma is smooth away from the singularities in the corners of the curve gamma. I will say in one minute what I mean by singularities in corners. Let me just say something about that. This regularity theory is the hard part of GMT. So this result is the sum of the work of many people like I think Federer. If you want to regularity at the interior, so you take a point of the interior of sigma and you want to prove that at some neighborhood of this point, this object is its actual surface, is smooth surface. Then you want to prove regularity of the free boundary. So you can use results of Grutter. Then you have the fixed boundary. So there is Hadid-Simon and Edelin. So it's a combination of the work of many people. So let me say what I mean by singularities and corners. So we're taking the intersection of a disk with my surface M. So these are two minimal surfaces, and we know that either the intersection is transverse or is tangent. And in the case of the two surfaces are tangent at that point, we know a local characterization. Suppose that P is on the interior of sigma. So we know that the local intersection is given by two K arcs with the same angle, okay, around P. And now we have the possibility that the disk and the surface M are tangent at the boundary. So you can have three situations, and you can think that the you have the sphere. So you can have situations like this. So you can guarantee that the intersection is at least one arc. Okay. So what I mean by singularity is that, because now maybe you are solving the plateau problem for something like this. So this point here is a singularity of the curve. Okay. Now what I mean by corner? Let me come back. Now consider this curve gamma. So let's consider a simple situation where my minimizer maybe is this. Okay. So these points here are corners of the surface. Okay. It's a point where the fixed boundary meets the free boundary. This is what I mean by corners. So maybe it's a problem that we don't have a regularity here. So actually it's not a problem, but Piana proved actually that sigma is regular at the corners. So it's a new regularity result, which was not known. Actually, we use a sketch, Grutter and Simon. They wrote a sketch of the proof, and we use the ideas of the sketch to prove our result. Okay. There is yet no regularity result for the singularities, but it's not really necessary for us, okay? So now that I solved my plateau problem, I will prove the following, that each component, maybe the surface sigma can be disconnected. For example, in this case, can be this piece of the disk and this piece of the disk, okay? But we can prove that each component is inside a disk. Why? Well, the boundary of sigma has two parts, a fixed and a free boundary. And if you look at second variation, you have a stability inequality. So you take any function, C infinity, which vanishes at the fixed boundary. So you see that the quadratic form associated with second variation as of this form. So now is a we have a solution of a minimization problem, we have stability. And we can prove that the stability inequality implies the sigma is totally geodesic. The idea is consider functions like that I considered before, like the position times a vector, okay? And you can prove with not much difficulty that using these functions, you can prove that sigma is totally geodesic. And on the case of you have singularities, you can perturb this function in some way, some perturbation of sigma epsilon for epsilon mach zero for almost every epsilon. And you can conclude the same result if you have a singularity like this. Okay, so it's not a problem for us. So what we know is the sigma is containing in each component is containing in some equatorial disk. We want to prove that is exactly the disk that I considered at the beginning. So first, the case that this sigma is inside the boundary of domain cannot happen because the maximum crispum, because I assumed at the beginning that M is not a disk, and you have a piece of M here, okay? This is just the classical maximum crispum. Now, a diameter to me is you take a straight line segment passed through the orange, okay, in the ball. Suppose that some component is not bounded by a diameter, then necessarily the component has to be in the disk G. Otherwise, it would be another disk, but the intersection between two disks is a straight line segment. So if this component is not a straight line segment, we obtain a contradiction. And the last case is, you have to prove actually there is no component bounded by a diameter. So suppose that is not true. So now we have a family of disks associated with this diameter. Something like this. So you can vary these disks along the family and obtain a first point of contact. So you can use all the versions of the maximum principle, the interior, the boundary, and you have actually used also a maximum principle in the corners. So these two maximum principles are known, and you have a version of the maximum principle due to Sahin in the corners. Okay? So we obtain a contradiction. So actually my minimizer is containing the disk B. So I did this for one of the domains. So I do for the other one. So if WVS this inside domain, then you obtain this minimizer for this curve. And if you do for WV prime, you obtain the other one. So at the end, when you do for the other domain, kicker suit another surface, and you know that the union of the two surfaces are the disk D. So now the you have the intersection of in with the D is the fixed boundary part of gamma. So this implies that any other component which is not the component which are fixed, we remind you that the boundary of this component is gamma. Any other component is in the half space, intersection of the half space with a ball, and this surface has just free boundary and not fixed boundary. So you can use again the maximal principle to exclude this. It will be a contradiction. So this finishes the proof. And we can extend this technique to prove another analog of a theorem of Hausdorff in this field. Suppose you have a region which is mean convex in the sense that you take the part of the boundary of the domain inside the interior of B3. Suppose this is smooth, it's mean convex, and intersect sigma orthogonally. So you can think in something like this. Okay. So using the same techniques, you can prove that if this region contains a diameter which is homological trivial, then the domain is a half ball. So, I'm sorry, I think I passed the time, just 1 minute and I'll finish.
No problem.
And just to say two things about applications of this result. First, you have an analog of a result of Solomon on the round tree sphere. Suppose you have a free boundary minimal surface, which is compact embedded. Then for each diameter, either sigma intersects this diameter or is linked with this diameter. What I mean by linked? We say that a diameter and the surface are linked if when you consider the complement of the ball with respect to the surface. Now, this curve here is not homotopically non-trivial with respect to the boundary. There is, yeah, and you can see that all those curves which the endpoints are in the sphere. So you can see that on the situation here, the picture, you cannot deform inside the domain between minus sigma. You cannot deform the curve gamma to just a point. So they are linked in this sense. So this essentially says that free boundary minimal surface cannot do some very crazy things in the sense of topological embeddings. Okay. And is essentially a corollary of the technique of the proof. You can see it's a corollary of this result. And just to finish, let me just remind you of the analog of the loss conjecture, which is a unicity of free boundary minima analysis. So we have partial results. We have a case of Reisen-Shen assuming that the first stack law of eigenvalue is 1. And also McGrath proved this result assuming that the sigma is symmetric with respect to the coordinate points. So at the end of last year, Q Q's name graph used the two-piece properties to prove another case of the conjecture. So suppose that sigma is a proper embedded minimal annulus, which is invariant by an antipodal map of the ball. So they prove that the sigma is congruent to the critical cardinality. And the idea is to use the two-piece property to achieve this result, and so prove the use the Fraser and chain result. So we're very happy to know that the result had another application. So let me stop here. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Vanderson. Okay, so there is any question or comments for Vanderson? So if not, I would like to thank Vanderson for the great talk, and hope, as you said before, I hope to see you soon in person here in Niterói. This is a crime that you didn't visit Niterói in 7 years.
No, so, I visited Niterói for the beaches, but I never been at the university.
No, for a mathematical course. So thank you very much. So thank you, everybody. We will see you later this afternoon.
Thank you, Asim.